The Midnight Gospel is one of the most unique and brilliant shows I've ever seen. Made by Pendleton Ward and Duncan Trussell, The Midnight Gospel is a surrealist dark comedy show that focuses on Clancy, a carefree but irresponsible spacecaster, which is basically just a podcast of space, uses a universe simulator to travel to simulated planets and interview people on those planets. Each episode focuses on Clancy's meager character, and they talk to each other about spirituality, death, philosophy, and other existential things in a podcast format, except with animated visuals that play into what people are talking about in normally incredibly vague ways, but still connected. Something I found really interesting about the show is the way these visuals are used, because while what the characters are talking about has overall meaning to the episodes, most of the time it doesn't relate to the visuals exactly. For example, episode 3 of the show focuses on this fish captain and Clancy going on a seaboard adventure on a ship full of very talented cats, but this episode ends with the fish captain turning into a giant and having a giant fight with this other guy. But Clancy and the fish captain don't talk about anything like that. They talk about meditation and a variety of different types of real life magic, like Zazen meditation, ceremonial magic, and such and such.
You know, I don't have very many friends just because magic is my life.
For sure.
I do this for hours and hours and hours a day. This is not something that I do as like a hobby or, you know, something on the side. This is the focal point of my life.
Sweet darling. I can tell.
What having these visuals don't, at least on first glance, seem to directly correlate to what everyone is talking about makes it feel difficult to focus on either thing, at least from my own experience. It's as if the visuals are almost there to distract you, and it's probably one of the reasons I felt I needed to rewatch the show so soon after I'd originally finished it. Another cool thing that took me a while to get, since I don't like looking at the production of shows before I've seen them, is that each and every episode uses audio from Duncan Trussell's own podcast, The Duncan Trussell Family Hour. For example, the fish is played by Damien Echoes, and the audio is taken from an episode he did with Duncan Trussell. So the reason why the dialogue in this show feels so natural and real is because, well, it is. The dialogue between Clancy and whoever he's talking to is a real conversation between Duncan and whoever was a guest on the podcast. Another really awesome detail of the show is how, instead of ADRing every mention of Duncan's name out, or every time they say the character's real name, with Clancy, they just leave a few nods in. It was a simple podcast. While you would think this would be something negative that would take you out of the world, and in a show made by less incredibly talented people, it would be a negative. It would break the fourth wall and it would feel annoying. But it becomes another detail you fall in love with time and time again, because a lot of them you don't notice, because you're so enthralled in this brilliant world. Clancy isn't a super nice person, and is shown to be very irresponsible several times throughout the show. Episode 6 is an episode that breaks all of the rules previously established. The podcast section of this episode with David Nitschen is only the last third of the episode, not even a full 5 minutes if I remember right. The episode mainly focuses on Clancy hasn't been taking care of his universal simulator, so it begins to malfunction. So this episode mainly focuses on Clancy's irresponsibility, and this episode is why the final episode of the show feels so brilliant to watch, and why it's one of my favourite episodes of television. But we will get to the final episode when we get there. Another example of Clancy's irresponsibility is how Clancy's sister calls him throughout the show, and she reveals how to get the simulator and start the spacecast, he borrowed money from her, and he hasn't paid it back. Clancy is running from his family and he's afraid to change who he is, and this scene spells it out pretty well.
Hello.
Clancy, it's Sarah.
Welcome to the official voicemail of Clancy Gilroy. Unfortunately, I'm too busy working on my very successful, very popular spacecast, but leave a message and either me or my assistant, Charlotte, will get back to you. Beep.
Fake voicemail thing doesn't work anymore, but that's okay. You don't have to answer. I just want you to know I love you, and if this is about the money, you don't need to pay me back. I know you moved to the ribbon to get a new start, but Clancy, no matter where you go, things are always gonna be the same if you don't change. To quote Mahatma Gandhi, there is a place in a man's heart, and wherever there's a rainbow, you can be sure that God's footprint.
Voicemail full. Message not received.
Clancy is very irresponsible and shows a huge lack of care for the people in his life. In the same episode, he steals what he needs to fix his simulator from the family of farmers. Clancy being so carefree ties into the whole show. Instead of being plot motivated, the whole show is a direct result of whatever Clancy's actions were, as he selects avatar after avatar, which within each episode means something slightly different, like how in the episode Titles of the Eclipse, Clancy believes that he understands himself, even though he actually doesn't, and that's represented by the avatar that he uses in this episode being a version of Clancy, except with the significant difference of being made entirely out of cream. Another great thing with the show that I mentioned earlier is the way the show is structured. Tying back into what I was on about earlier with the way episodes are directed in a way that makes it difficult to focus on both the dialogue and the visuals, this could be construed as how Clancy is focusing in these episodes. He doesn't really seem to pay attention to what the people are saying, but much more what's going on in the episode. The show focuses a lot on specifically spirituality, like what people believe in, and death. The first episode is based on a podcast that Duncan did with Dr. Drew Pitsky. The episode itself mainly focuses on drugs and how
there's no such thing as a bad drug. It's the circumstances.
This episode in particular has a lot of death in it. Death plagues the episode's visuals. Almost everyone shown on screen dies and becomes a zombie, only to be cured again by a drug. Episode 2 of the show, Officers and Wolves, is a talk that Duncan had with Annie Lamont and Raghu Marcus, and Annie herself says,
I've actually had a lot of deaths in my life.
And the rest of the episode itself seems to be an analogy about the cattle industry, which in itself inherently has a lot of death involved in it. Episode 3 is set in a post-apocalyptic world that ends with a brawl to the death. Episode 4 ends with the destruction of the whole planet. I'll get back to episode 5. Episode 6 is Clancy's short-lived friend inadvertently killed by Clancy. Episode 7 literally stars Death, played by Caitlin Doughty, and we'll talk about episode 8 in just a bit. Episode 5 is definitely my second favourite episode of the show, and it's the one that has the closest connection to Death in my opinion, at least from a writing perspective. The episode is Clancy talking to the Soulbird. Soulbirds are creatures who put prisoners in the Soul Prison in a time loop until they're deserving of freedom. Every time Bob dies, a scene occurs where these gods look at Bob's heart, and if his heart isn't pure, he's restarted to the beginning just after Clancy arrived. I will let the show explain itself, but the show is also really brilliant at show and tell, and the Soulbird isn't explained through dialogue but like a 3-minute clip. I really don't want to bloat this video or get it blocked in other countries. Visuals of this episode are pretty much a time loop where Bob learns how to escape, where Clancy and the Soulbird, played by Jason Louv, just talk about consciousness and non-essentialism.
Wait, you were talking about,
Hindu theory, Indra's net.
Right.
So the concept is that all the consciousnesses in the world are connected. Imagine like a giant net, like a glowing blue net in infinity.
Like a quilt?
No, more like a net.
Then we reach episode 8, which is by far my favourite episode of television, full stop. The episode begins with the normal stuff. Clancy gets into the simulator, but just before he jets off, a door appears.
One.
Hold on one sec.
Okay.
Mom? Hi, Mom.
Hi, Duncan.
Would you be in my vidcast?
Clancy's mother is voiced by Duncan Trussell's own mother, Deneen Fendig. Unfortunately, Deneen died of breast cancer in 2013, before the show would have started production. This, in my opinion, is definitely one of the reasons the show was made, and probably why the show focuses on death so much. I can't really talk about this episode. Like, it's difficult to explain why this episode is so brilliant, why the direction of the animation is just so fantastic. It's probably all to do with the fact that it's a real conversation between a real dying mother and her real son. This episode is the only one in the series that made me cry, and it's also one of the only ones that made me laugh out loud in my room. Like, the episode focuses on life itself, from being born, what it means to be a mother, a son, and they talk about how the formative years, and it's... In the episode, I didn't notice how Clancy was never called by his actual name. Every single time it's Duncan. I was just so invested in this episode that this seemingly detail that would take you out, it would take you out of any show that was slightly inferior, but it's just this brilliant experience that I've been trying to put into words for like 2 weeks of writing this video, and I just couldn't. So I just thought, fuck it, I'll improv it. And it just, all I can say is that it's brilliant, and it's for so many reasons, it's my favourite episode of television. And sure, I'm overhyping it, but I don't care. It's that good. Thank you, Duncan Trussell and Pendleton Ward, for making this masterpiece. I can't put this show into words as to why this episode in particular I love so much. So I'm just going to play a clip that on YouTube has 2 million views that I think speaks for itself. Thank you for watching, and thank you again to Duncan Trussell and Pendleton Ward for making this. I look forward to seeing whatever you guys decide to make next.
Kind of brings us to the idea to something that you have been dealing with for 4 years now, which is that you have stage 4 bone cancer.
Metastatic breast cancer.
Metastatic breast cancer. And this is an extreme, extreme version of a tornado knocking a house down, because 4 years ago you called to tell us that you had 6 months to live.
I have been told that at least a dozen times.
A dozen times that you've had 6 months to live.
I have been told to call a crematorium and find out how much it would cost to be cremated, because I had maybe a month or 6 weeks, and that I needed to know that so that I could pay the money up front before I died. And I have made the call to the crematorium, and I found out that it was $750. Thank you very much.
Wow. God, that is so fucked.
The possibility that there is some kind of force that will take us out when it's time to go out is nothing that I can do anything about.
Right.
So I may as well make peace with it.
Right.
It's easier to go with the flow of that particular river than it is to try to fight it. That there is that possibility. We're all gonna die.
I know. And and this is that saying, and I don't know where it comes from, but that meditation is preparation for death.
I think that's true. And meditation is one spiritual practice that prepares us for death. But also, you know, if you look at the world, what you see is things appearing and disappearing. And humans are a part of the whole of that. And humans appear and they disappear off the face of the earth. That just happens. You know, our egos personalize it, and we consider ourselves special cases.
Yes.
But we're really not, you know? We are part of the whole, and everything in the whole transforms all the time. Changes form, transfigures.
You're a special case.
It's because I'm your mama.
No! No, this, I know this transfigure, I know, but come on, there's no way to stop the heartbreak. What do you do about that?
You cry. You cry.